Good afternoon, everyone present here. I, Dr. Mohana Basu, faculty, Department of Geography, Profullo Chandra College, on behalf of our college, extend a very sincere, warm welcome to all of you present here in this one-day state-level webinar organized by the Department of Geography, Profullo Chandra College, in collaboration with Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharya College. Today's webinar is in a very relevant issue of immense concern, effects of global warming on coastal environments. Global warming, the gradual heating of the Earth's surface, ocean, and atmosphere is caused due to the increase of carbon dioxide, methane, and other greenhouse gases, and also due to the burning of fossil fuels. Anthropogenic activities also play a very significant role in global warming. Global warming is expected to have far-reaching, long-lasting, and in many cases, devastating consequences for the planet Earth. Despite political controversy about climate change, a major report released by IPCC in September 27, 2013, stated that scientists are more certain than ever of the link between human activities and global warming. Again, human activities are also to a certain extent responsible for the changes of the coastal environment. Increase of temperature due to global warming have several implications on coastal areas, and immediate physical change is warming of the sea surface temperatures, which can result in more frequent algal blooms and coral bleaching. One of the most certain consequences of global warming is an increase of global sea level. The resulting inundation from rising sea levels will heavily impact the low-lying areas, the very existence of some island states and deltaic coasts is threatened. Apart from these, there has been loss of biodiversity, high levels of pollution, and coastal erosions as a result of climate change triggered by global warming. In India, we have a very long coastline of about 7,516 kilometers comprising of coastal areas. Hence, in this regard, today's issue, that is the impact of global warming on coastal environment, is quite relevant as far as our country's context is concerned. In today's webinar, we have Professor Ashish Pal, who will enlighten us on the effects of global warming on coastal environment in detail. Our chief patron is our Honorable Principal, Dr. Ratnakar Pani. Before our principal inaugurates this webinar, I would request all the participants to kindly keep your audios off. Sir, Dr. Ratnakar Pani, I request you to kindly inaugurate the webinar and please forward your inauguration speech. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Moshumi. Good afternoon to all of you. I welcome you all to this state-level webinar on effect of global warming on coastal environment, organized by the Department of Geography of our college in association with the Department of Geography of Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharya College. I heartily welcome our distinguished speakers, Professor Ashish Kumar Pal, Professor of the Department of Geography, Vidyasagar University, and President, Indian Institute of Geomorphologists, and Professor Prithish Kumar Roy, Department of Geography of our college. I also welcome all the participants and my colleagues to this webinar. In the present scenario of COVID-19 pandemic, when we are confined at home and are not able to move freely except for urgent works, we are connected today in the webinar to discuss such a vital issue. Since this issue, I suppose, the greatest concern all over the world today, and we are supposedly approaching towards a disaster, a seminar on this topic could be more effective in comprehending the situation. I must request the Department of Geography to conduct an international seminar on this issue for a more effective comprehending of the situation. However, I congratulate the Department of Geography of both the colleges for arranging a webinar on this pertinent issue. We know that global warming is an unwanted byproduct of greenhouse gas emission, which is also an undesirable byproduct of human activity, mostly economic activities. We also know that greenhouse gas are the gases that trap heat in the atmosphere. Greenhouse gases consist mainly of carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, fluorinated gases, water vapor, etc. Sources of greenhouse gases may be categorized as natural or unavoidable sources and man-made or avoidable sources. Major examples of natural sources are volcanic eruption, forest fire, breathing and excretion activities of living beings. Man-made sources include emission generated due to activities ranging from preparation of food to industrial activities based on burning fossil fuel like coal, petroleum, gases, wood, and other byproducts. Let us visualize the system of global warming due to emission of greenhouse gases. Let me share my screen first. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Now, this is our Earth's surface. When sun rises, it gives us sufficient sunlight as well as heat. There is a ozone layer to filter the sun rays, particularly the hazardous or problematic ray like infrared, like ultraviolet ray to the Earth. Earth get warm, then it reflect back the additional rays or heats to the atmosphere beyond a particular level, which does not warm the Earth surface much more. When we pollute the environment, what happens? First of all, the ozone layer is being get hold, so the direct sunlight comes to the Earth. What happens? The ray when goes bounce to the atmosphere, it is covered by the blanket through the pollution and get back once again to the Earth and makes the Earth more warmer than expected. So that is called the greenhouse gas effect. This is a very simple version of greenhouse gas effect. What happens when the global warming takes place? Water crisis occurs. The land area get dried, frequent forest fires occur, severe cyclones occur, creatures get die, the snows and ice get melted. Now it increases the sea level, and as per IPCC, they have marked when the sea is coming to our Earth's surface. By 2030, they have marked one place, and by 2050, they also marked another place. The coastal area is the vulnerable area which will get affected due to sea level rise. A number of cities, particularly in the lowland, they are going to be submerged. According to a satellite prediction of NASA, every year, on an average, 3.3 millimeter rise in sea level are visible. The global temperature after industrialization, after massive industrialization, has gone up. It is about 0.8 degree to 1 degree more than pre-industrial revolution era. If we look at the greenhouse gas composition, we will find carbon dioxide is the most important greenhouse gas, which accounts for more than 76%, of which 65% is fossil fuel and industrial process, and other 11%. Methane 16%, nitrous oxide 6%, and other gases 2%. Now, if we look at the growth rate of CO2 concentration on the atmosphere, we will find about a billion years ago, till in industrial revolution, there was a stable carbon dioxide composition in the atmosphere. It was from roughly 180 ppm to 300 ppm with certain fluctuations. But since start of this century, it's gone up more than 400 ppm. Now, if we will look at the regional emission level, we will find that till 1900, there was very low. Pre-industrialized period, there was very insignificant level of carbon dioxide emission. After that, till the end of 19th century, there was very low level emission. But after that, particularly after 1950s, the carbon dioxide emission has gone up rapidly. In the first stage, European countries and United States, other developed countries were the highest emitter. But right now, China, India, and the developing countries are the most emitter of the world, where United States, although the second highest emitter, but it is reducing years after year. Now, if we look at the sector-wise carbon dioxide emission, we will find the electricity and heat production accounts for 25%, other energy generation account for 10%, industry 21%, agriculture, forestry, and other land use 24%, transportation 14%, building 6%, according to IPCC 2014. Now, there was a very good statement by Solaripus Foundation. At the pace of current CO2 emission, scientists expect an increase of between somewhere between 1.5 and 5.3 degrees centigrade by the end of this century. If no action is taken, it would have harmful consequence to humanity and the biosphere. The obvious impacts of global warming on biodiversity, global warming disbalances ecosystem, change the condition and cycles of plant reproduction. According to the IPCC, a 1.5 degree average rise in temperature leads 20 to 30% of species at risk of extinction. If the planet warms by more than 2%, most ecosystems will struggle. Scarcity of resources and climate change force many living species to migrate. Intrusion of invasive species will threat crops and other animals. On ocean, because of global warming, permafrost and ice are melting, increasing the sea level. In a century, the increase reached 18 centimeter. Already it reached 18 centimeter higher than the previous century, 6 centimeter in the last 20 years. The worst case scenario will be a rise up to 1 meter by 2100. The acidification of the ocean due to CO2 capture is also of great concern, since it makes sea cells and coral reef vulnerable. On human, climate change is affecting the global economy. It is already shaking up social, health, geopolitical balances in many parts of the world. The scarcity of resources like food and energy gives rise to new conflict. Rising sea level and floods are causing population migration. Small islands, states are in the front line. The estimated number of climate refugees by 2050 is 250 million people. Now on weather, more droughts and heat waves, more precipitations, more natural disasters like flood, hurricanes, storms and wildfires, frost free seasons, etc. Now, what are the ways we can stop global warming? Very few are given here. I think our distinguished guests will elaborately discuss. 7 R's: rethink, refuse, reduce, reuse, recycle, restore, renew. To explain, try to avoid unsustainable activities. If not possible, reduce to minimum. Use energy efficient technologies. Use clean fuel. Go green. Conserve water. Create awareness. Educate women. These are the things may be suggested to stop global warming. These are my brief analysis about the situation. I believe the distinguished speaker will elaborately discuss on the issue. I thank you, the Department of Geography and the organizing team, and thank you all for joining this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Principal Sir, for your mesmerizing our technical sessions. I would like to request all the participants to kindly post your questions, if any, in the chat box and kindly mention the speaker for whom you have the questions. The question answer session will be conducted after the technical session gets over. Now I would like to introduce you our keynote speaker, who is an extremely multi-talented person. Personally, I have been fortunate enough to witness practically how seamlessly he manages academic as well as administrative responsibilities. This is not all. He is an extremely renowned author as well. He has written several books, and his contribution, especially in the field of economic geography, is undoubtedly unparalleled. He has books written in both English and Bengali versions. He also has books in the field of climatic geography. Now comes his administrative responsibilities. He is the vice principal and also the head of the Department of Geography of Profullo Chandra College at present. He has been an ex-professor of St. Xavier's College. He is the president of governing body of Howrah Norosingho Dutta College, and he is also the GB member of several colleges like Herombo Chandra College, Muralidhar Girls College, Shippur Dinobondhu College, and many others. So I suppose you can guess who our keynote speaker is. Yes, he is none other than Professor Prithish Kumar Roy. I would request sir to kindly deliver his lecture. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mohana Basu. I consider myself privileged to be associated with the webinar Effects of Social Warming on Coastal Environment. Am I audible, Mohana?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. Global warming is now a reality. It is no more a subject matter of science fiction. Previously, most of the politicians and the doyens of different fields of activities, they thought that it is a magnification of the problem by the academicians, and in reality, hardly there is any global warming taking place in this part of the world. And Donald Trump, the mighty president of United States, still thinks in that line that global warming is a ballooned perception of some academicians. So global warming is now a reality. It is no more a subject matter of science fiction. In the coming US election campaign, President aspirant Joe Biden has taken global warming a prime issue and alleged that President Trump has failed to address this issue properly. So this has become a political agenda now. And we know that Green Party in Europe has taken its stand even 40 years back. So climate issue is now one of the leading issue for the survival of mankind. And it is gaining momentum everywhere, every country, even in the common people. So popular misconception is global warming is the handiwork of human being only. But ever since the formation of atmosphere, global warming and global cooling or glaciation was a natural cyclical climatic phenomena happened here, different period of time in different geologic era. Even before the advent of human species, Earth had experienced repetitive warming followed by cold wave, resulting mass extinction of species in different period, and most of the commoners, they already knew that Jurassic period is like that period when mass extinction has taken place. So volcanic eruptions explosion of meteorites on Earth's surface, forest fire, each are capable enough to increase global temperature at a very alarming level. Some of the participants must know that there is a forest fire now going on in California region in US. The total carbon emission from that forest fire is more than the combined carbon emission by the industrialization in the last 2-3 years. A particular, a regular volcanic eruption in Indonesia may exceed even the cumulative carbon emission by human beings. So we must keep in mind that even if there is no human interference or human misdeed, there will be climate change in one day or another. The past recorded history proves that. So ever since solidification of Earth crust had taken place, coastal areas had been affected by sea level change in different time. Warming and cooling period of atmosphere is quite influencing the emergence of coastal water in the land area and receding of coastal area. So global warming had inundated coastline and cooling had resulted retreat of coastal water. These are cyclical and very natural. So human being is not alone responsible for coastal inundation. There are some other regions. But since Industrial Revolution, human activities had aggravated it in an alarming level, no denying fact. Intergovernmental Panel of Climate Change, that is IPCC, is now monitoring it and suggesting remedial measures. As far as coasts are concerned, India is having huge low-lying coastal areas which are visibly facing inundation at a regular interval in recent time. Few days back, Sundarban areas had experienced recurrence of tidal water engulfing the inland areas, and this saline water had destroyed vast areas of agricultural land. Along with that, aquifers were influenced by the saline water. Salinity has increased a lot. Even the Kathi area, or more particularly in Digha area, the high tidal surge has inundated large tracts which were not hitherto been seen in recent years. So things are getting worsened, and coming days will witness even worse situation. So West Bengal coastal areas are typically vulnerable, and vast majority of coastal population is facing imminent danger of eviction and displacement. Dr. Ashish Pal will elaborate this issue, but I would like to present a small PPT. Let me show you. Oh, is it visible now, Mohana?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay. So let us see the situation 30 years back. Climate change is imminently visible in recent years. So there were scattered news reports through the decades, including a remarkably clear article in the New York Times that conveyed how accumulating greenhouse gas emissions from energy production. IPCC, which was established in 1988, is doing a remarkable job, and they are monitoring it, but some people and some of the academicians are skeptical about their efficacy of IPCC. So there might be some political reason, there might be some political implication of that IPCC, and IPCC, it is alleged, that is sometimes influenced by political decisions. The crystallizing moment came on June 23, 1988, when James E. Hansen, a climate scientist who had turned his intention from studying the shearing conditions on Venus to Earth's human-changed atmosphere. He says that some other day Venus was also habitable, and that was changed due to some atmospheric change, and greenhouse effect has been, so global warming and its impact on coastal region, that is our focal theme. All coast, everywhere except some higher reaches in Africa are adversely affected by many stresses. These include not only local construction or pollution. In addition, coasts are increasingly facing global threats from climate change. These trends are primarily due to indiscriminate burning of the fossil fuel. Everybody knows that. I'm not discussing this. Since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, the atmospheric CO2 concentration increased from 280 parts per million to 1800 to a level of 400 ppm today. So in 1800, it was only 280 parts per million. Now it has increased to 400 ppm. But some of the experts nowadays says that due to lockdown period, due to the cessation of industrial activities and economic activities, the CO2 level has slightly marginally improved. And if this thing remain unabated, then in the coming days, maybe we come across a solution level. So next, green global mean estimates based on land and ocean data. Temperature anomaly has taken place. If we take this chart seriously, then from minus 2 level to it has increased to 1. That is more than 10 times, more than 10 times. So this is about global greenhouse gas emission by economic sector. So from this diagram, it is quite clear agricultural activities along with forestry and other land use still contributes 24%. It is a misconception that agriculture is a docile activity. It cannot harm atmosphere, but this is not true, because methane is one of the greatest contributor in the greenhouse emission, and methane is coming out from rice cultivation mostly. So this is to be considered seriously. And electricity and heat production 25% in emerging countries like India, like China, still we use huge amount of thermal power, that is power mainly coming out from the burning of fossil fuel, that is coal. So coal-based projects are still very much pertinent in the emerging economy, particularly in China and in India. Even still we produce bulk of our electricity from coal. While in Europe and US, in the developed countries, they have converted it to the more cleaner fuel, maybe sometimes nuclear or mostly gas-based power projects. So industry contributes 21%. So we cannot blame industry alone for this global warming. So this is the major greenhouse gases from people's activities: carbon dioxide, methane, other gases, nitrous oxide, then fluorinated gases. This is by intergovernmental panel. Some specific impacts that may occur in estuaries and other coastal areas include salt water intrusion that I have mentioned, that salinity has increased a lot, and that has there was an intrusion in the groundwater. Even they are taking out groundwater in the Sundarban areas, these waters are also has become saline, and that is not acceptable for agriculture. Flooding of coastal wetlands and marshes, more and more rescue centers are to be built, because Sundarban is now prone to this climatic disorder. Regular disaster will happen here. In the last few years, 20 years, experience has clearly indicating that in the coming days, we have to be more careful and we must take some precautionary measures. The changes in habitat and species distributions, more salinity will push the habitat, the animals, the dependent on the normal water, that is inland water. So they will again shift from Sundarban area to other areas. There are some possibilities. Changes to water availability and quality, changes in habitat, lowering of oxygen level in wetlands, ocean acidification, impacts of several coastal storms. So coastal storms has increased a lot. In the last few years, you have experienced lots of cyclones are coming at a regular interval, particularly just before the onset of monsoon, as if these storms are now showing the path of monsoon, and monsoon is now being diverted to other areas from their normal routes. So this is a regular affair nowadays. So if I get scope, then in another webinar or seminar we will discuss this. Hope we will arrange this in the later half. So the greatest threat, sea level rise, inundation of coastal colonies. India is one of the 28 countries endangered from sea level rise, because Indian coastline are huge. In fact, everywhere in the eastern part and western part, southern part, India is having huge amount of coastline. Total area is given here, 4.6% of the coastal population will be affected. The density of population in coastal India is huge. In fact, along with, if you start from West Bengal to Odisha to Andhra Pradesh to eastern coastal areas till Kerala, population density is highest in India as well as in the world. Then regions vulnerable to sea level rise. So I'm not taking much time. Let us switch over to another. Where most people are affected by rising sea level. This map shows where the people are affected more, 10 to 15 million, then 1 to 9 million. So yearly rise trend at 10 major ports. These ports are vulnerable. In fact, most of the ports in India, right from Mumbai to Vizag, Paradip, Chennai, Kochi, and Calcutta and Haldia, these all are vulnerable. Even if this sea level rise, which is happening in the recent past, remain unabated, then days may come when these ports are to be shifted inland. Otherwise, it will not be workable. Then coastal elevation, this is given here. This graphic shows the coastal elevation. The low-lying areas will be affected first, but even the interior part will be affected. Then sea level rise trend and fifth order polynomial curve at the station Visakhapatnam. That is a case study that is showing that some areas are more vulnerable, and Visakhapatnam, this is a case study. Then seawater intrusion, the vulnerability areas increase with every 0.5 meter rise in sea level, maximum near the creeks and minimum along main coast. Irrigated agriculture, coastal tourism and other activities at risk. Saline water may make the coastal land unsuitable for agriculture. Two islands already vanished from Sundarbans, displacing 7,000 people and several islands at risk. Dr. Ashish Pal is quite familiar with this area. He has intensely worked in those areas, so he will give you details of how some of the islands like Ghoramara or other Mousumi islands are on the verge of extinction. So sea level increase causing floods and vulnerability of Asian coastal cities. Most of the cities are vulnerable. According to the new study, 300 million people globally live on land that will flood at least once a year by 2050. Bangladesh is one of the countries that are on the verge of deluge. In fact, some of the areas are still, people are underwater, remain underwater 6 to 7 months. So these are the areas which are susceptible to this kind of disaster. Very highly prone, moderately prone, less prone. Cyclone hazard prone districts of India. Cyclone vulnerability of eastern coastal India. More than 40% cyclones over the last 100 years crossed through the Sundarban. I think Dr. Pal will elaborate this. Rising sea putting wildlife at risk. This wildlife are at risk globally as well as in India. The impact of climate change on soil salinity in coastal regions and loss of biodiversity. Mangrove extent, how they are receding from their erstwhile areas. Shoreline change. This is a trend where high erosion has taken place, where moderate erosion has taken place. Ocean acidification. This is another problem due to this ocean acidification. If greenhouse gas increases, acidification of ocean will take place, and ocean acidification will destroy the coral reefs and other habitats because they are not very habitual. They are not very accustomed with this type of acidification. And then mitigation measures, what are the measures recommended by IPCC? Identify coast areas, population and resource, develop global and regional research, develop public awareness, encourage integrated coastal area and resource management, use country-specific studies, develop techniques for mitigation, adopt a framework. And finally, not the least, that is the uniformity of uniform and rational thinking of the world leaders. They should first agree on certain things, and mitigation measures is only possible. Otherwise, some of the countries, even after signing the pact, they are not obeying this pact and they are deviating from their assurances. So thank you. Now, this is my small presentation. Let us come to this next speaker, that is the now I would like to introduce our own Dr. Ashish Kumar Pal for his presentation. Dr. Ashish Pal is now considered one of the most revered coastal geomorphologists in present India. Am I audible, Mohana?
Audible. Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Okay. Dr. Ashish Pal is now considered one of the most revered coastal geomorphologists in present India. I had this rare privilege to witness his beginning of coastal geomorphology studies research along with Dr. Sunanda Bandyopadhyay under Professor Maratos Bandyopadhyay. Right, yes. From the beginning, Dr. Pal was obsessed with coastal studies, coastal geomorphology. This can be comparable with Arjuna and the Eye of Fish story. He has never took off his eyes from the coastal geomorphology. Now he is the president, Institute of Geomorphologists. He is the former head, Department of Geography, Vidyasagar University, and presently teaching in Vidyasagar University as a professor. Around 30 scholars had completed PhD under his guidance. If I am not right, if I am right, then there are numerous research papers in his credit. It is very difficult to count the number of research papers. He had authored 4 books which are widely circulated all over India. And I personally feel after Rao and Baidyanathan, Professor Dr. Ashish Kumar Pal is the last word of coastal geomorphology. Dr. Pal is nowadays synonymous with coastal study. So thank you, Dr. Pal, for coming to our webinar. So I would like to request you to present your lecture. Over to Dr. Ashish Kumar Pal.
Thank you. So I convey my gratitude to the Vice Principal of Prafulla Chandra College, Dr. Prithish Roy, and Principal Sir, and the total team of Prafulla Chandra College, and the team of Dr. Kanailal Bhattacharya College. And also, I convey my regards to the webinar participants, the registered participants who will follow the lecture on the effects of global warming on coastal environments. I have categorized my entire lecture into 2 parts. One is the global warming, and the second part is the effects of global warming on coastal environments of India, particularly in reference to India. I'll discuss on the basis of my observations. So in the background of the first slide, you can see that this is one village of the Sundarban, which is the most low-lying areas of the coastal parts of India. And here you can see that how the huge volume of the surface sediments have been removed due to the tidal surges, repeated tidal surges, and the recession of the shoreline also taken place, and the settlements of the inner parts of the islands have been exposed in many islands of the Sundarban. Particularly, those islands are actually reclaimed historically. So now, the global warming, the properties of the Earth surface through albedo effects, and the composition of the atmosphere primarily through concentrations of greenhouse gases play a critical role in regulating the Earth's temperature. The most important greenhouse gases are water vapor, carbon dioxide, and methane, and their concentrations are subject to change through natural change, through natural causes, and through human emissions. The IPCC reports radiative forcing relative to a pre-industrial background of 1750. For example, in 2005, CO2 had a radiative forcing of 1.49 to 1.83 watts per square meter, whereas cloud albedo effects generated a cooling of minus 1.8 to minus 0.3 watt per square meter. The net total contribution of anthropogenic factors was 0.6 to 2.4 watts per square meter, mostly due to the emissions of greenhouse gases since the Industrial Revolution. The concentration of atmospheric CO2 has increased from 280 ppm in pre-industrial times to 400 ppm in 2013. As a consequence of this increased CO2 concentration in the atmosphere, the average global temperature during the 20th century increased by 0.74 plus minus 0.18 degree centigrade, while sea level rose by 0.17 plus minus 0.02 meter. So now in the second part, the IPCC special report highlights the status of the temperatures. In 2019, it is 1.0 degree centigrade, and it is estimated that it will be 1.5 degree centigrade to 1.8 degree centigrade in 2050 if it is not controlled by the people of the world. And then in 2100, it will be 2.0 degree centigrade or more. The report finds that limiting global warming to 1.5 degree centigrade would require a rapid and far-reaching transitions in land, energy, industry, buildings, transport, and cities. Global net human-caused emissions of carbon dioxide would need to fall by about 45% from 2010 levels by 2030. Reaching net zero around 2050. This means that any remaining emissions would need to be balanced by reaching CO2 from the air. So here in the greenhouse effects, you can see that how the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere has increased gradually, and the predicted warming and actual warming up to 2050, you can see that the temperature, how it is increased gradually. So if there is 1.8 degree centigrade temperatures in 2050, then there will be the dramatic effects over the coastal areas, over the globe. So now, warming is not the new thing because warming and cooling phases are actually recorded from the rock records of the world by the geologists and the biologists and the many researchers. Particularly if we consider the Precambrian era, from this slide you can see that how the phases of the warming and the cooling actually took place in the past geologically. In the Precambrian era, it is estimated that the Earth formed about 4,600 million years ago. The first sedimentary rocks were laid down some 3,700 million years ago in the Precambrian era, when it is believed the climate was some 10 degrees centigrade warmer than now. Imagine it. All we know is that at some time between 2700 and 1800 billion years ago, glaciers and ice sheets were widespread. Thereafter, it seems the Earth was warm and free of ice caps and glaciers from 800 million years. The late Precambrian, from the diagram you can see that, from the late Precambrian period, which began about 1000 million years ago, and included three distinct glacial episodes, each lasting some 100 million years. Then the Paleozoic and Mesozoic eras, the era from 570 to 245 million years ago, is known as the Paleozoic. Evidence of a brief glacial period about 450 million years ago can be found in the rock formations of the Sahara. However, the climate was warmed since 570 to 400 million years ago during the era. During the following period, the Carboniferous temperatures dropped, culminating in the long Permo-Carboniferous glaciation from 330 to 245 million years ago. During the Mesozoic era, from 245 to 65 million years ago, when Pangaea broke up into two enormous land masses, the climate was generally warm. There is evidence of some fluctuations in climate throughout this era, and there may have been a sudden brief cooling at the end of the era that coincided with the mass extinction of the dinosaurs. The Cenozoic era, here from this particular diagram, the history of the warming and cooling phase from Pleistocene to Holocene. Here you can see that how the Pleistocene glaciation extended over a long time in the geology. And then the warming also started after 10,000 years before present. And then it continued till present, except some little ice age period. The Cenozoic covers the last 65 million years of the Earth's history. The era involved a long-term cooling trend and indicated major cooling events about 50 and 38 million years ago. Further cooling took place at 15 million years ago. The second period of the Cenozoic era is the Quaternary, which started about 1.6 million years ago and includes the present time. The period began with the Pleistocene epoch, during which there were 7 glaciations with up to 32% of the Earth's surface covered by ice. These ice ages occurred roughly every 100,000 years and were interspersed with shorter warm interglaciations. So these warm interglacials are the signatures of the global warming phases in the rock records. The most recent glacial period reached in peak about 18,000 years ago. Then about 12,000 years ago, a dramatic warming began, and by 7,000 years ago, the North American and Scandinavian ice sheets had melted. As sea level rose, the coastlines of the continents gradually assumed their present shape. We are living in the Holocene epoch at present, a warm period that began 10,000 years ago. We may well be in an interglacial period that will end with another ice age. So from this diagram, you can see that how the Pleistocene glaciation took place, and with the little ice age in between these two situations, there were the warming phases in the Holocene epoch, and then ultimately we have to wait for the another interglacial period. Next, another point is very significant for the cases of Indian coastlines over the Arabian Sea fringe area and also the Bay of Bengal fringe area. That is the Indian Ocean dipole process. Over the last three decades, the oceanographers actually observed the impacts of the Indian Ocean dipole process over the temperature conditions, SST conditions, and the formations of the cyclones, and also the huge amount of the rainfall occurrences over the coastal belts. This coupled ocean atmospheric phenomenon, in which convection, winds, sea surface temperatures, and thermocline take part actively, is known as the Indian Ocean Dipole. During Indian Ocean Dipole events, biological productivity of the Eastern Indian Ocean increases, and this in turn leads to death of corals over a large area. Moreover, the IOD effects rainfall over the maritime continent of the Indian Ocean, Indian subcontinent, Australia, and Eastern Africa. The maritime continent and Australia suffer from deficit rainfall, whereas India and East Africa receive excess. There is an increase in frequency of the IOD events in the recent decades. Recent three decades are very important for the cases of IOD events. Now, about 50%, of the IOD events in the past 100 years have co-occurred with El Nino southern oscillations and the other half independently. However, the hypothesis based on observations indicated that the IOD events develop either in the presence or absence of ENSO. The IOD events co-occurring during the ENSO are forced by a zonal shift in the descending branch of Walker Cell over the Eastern Indian Ocean. Here, from this diagram, you can see that just along the equator and its adjacent area, the thermocline is located just 80 meters below the sea surface. But now, very recently, in the last three decades, what we have seen that the thermocline has uplifted towards the western part of the Indian Ocean near the African coastal area. That means it has raised up to 60 meters, that means 10 meters uplifted. So that means now it is the thickness of the water column within the thermocline, that is the 60 meters. And so automatically on the eastern part, it will be subsided. So in this way, just like a seesaw effects, it takes place. When the upliftment of the thermocline takes place, then the atmospheric interaction starts, and through the convection and also the permission of rain, occurrences of the rain and SST will be increased. So what we have seen, the effects of the IOD over the western coast very recently in the last few decades, and also over the eastern coast of India. So next, I am coming to the part as the effects of global warming. Burning fossil fuels, deforestation, and industrial agriculture release carbon dioxide and other heat-trapping gases into our atmosphere, causing our planet to warm. The ocean has buffered us from the worst impacts of climate change by absorbing more than 90% of this excess heat and about 25% of the CO2, but at the cost of causing significant harm to marine ecosystems. Here, from this diagram, you can see that the climate change actually producing a triple threat for the ocean. So when the excess temperature within the atmosphere, and among them 90% heat, are actually absorbed by the marine systems or the ocean systems, so getting heated, so warmer, so ocean becoming warmer and warmer, and less oxygen actually content are actually found, but it is already measured by the scientists in the ocean waters. And then the more than 25% excess CO2 are also absorbed by the ocean, so for which the ocean water is now getting more acidic. So my observations are actually concentrated just in and around of India, Indian coastal areas. And then ultimately we are getting the results as the sea level changes, sea level rise is accelerating, flooding coastal communities and drowning wetland habitats. Warm water coral reefs could be lost if the planet warms by 2 degrees centigrade. Then larger and more frequent blooms are making fish, birds, marine mammals, and people sick. Lower oxygen levels are suffocating some marine animals and shrinking their habitats. More acidic water harms animals that build cells, such as corals, clams, and oysters. Disruptions in fisheries affect the marine food web, local livelihoods, and global food security. And from this diagram, I can show you that how the coastal chaos is created in our west coast and the east coast of India. Now, the system disorder actually has taken place in the coastal environment. And that system disorder is caused by global warming, sea level rise, coastal inundations, and coastal erosions. And there are consequences of the east causes of the system disorder. That means consequences of global warming, consequences of sea level rise, consequences of coastal inundations, and consequences of coastal erosion. So all these the disorder systems have created a critical coastal chaotic situations over the geomorphology, over the hydrodynamics of the coastal areas of Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea. So ultimately, what we have observed that the frequency of the atmospheric hazards, hydrologic hazards, and geomorphic hazards that has been taken place in and around the 7,500 kilometers or and the island coast of our country. So now, global climate is a major forcing factor of coastal processes and geomorphological dynamism. So the impacts of climate change can be studied on the three major items, that is the physical systems and the ecological systems and the socioeconomic systems of the coastal area that I have observed over 40 years in the coastal areas of India. So now, this is the diagram. You can see that coastal areas include the two subsystems. One is the natural subsystem, and second is the societal subsystem. So now, over this natural and societal subsystems, the external marine influences and the external terrestrial influences are actually increasing day by day, caused by the intensity and magnitude of the storms, the intensity and the impacts of the significant wave heights, then sea level rises, and from the ground, from the continental areas, that is the temperatures, and then CO2 concentrations and runoff. So ultimately, by these two impacts, both from the land and also from the marine areas, the transitional coastal belts are getting actually affected seriously. And that's why we are getting the several impacts over the coastal zones of India at present. So now, the Sundarban area and Godavari deltaic area and Kaveri deltaic area, and also in some parts of Krishna, I have seen that the coastal floods and the coastal erosions, these two phenomena are actually so critical and so complex that at any time only because of the eastern winds or by the swell waves, the areas after areas getting affected by flooded on erosions, and at the same time by the erosions. Here you can see that how the villages fringed with the coastal belts of the Sundarban are getting affected in the sunny day just by the impact of the eastern winds. How the communities of the coastal belt areas are actually surviving in the different island sectors, which are particularly reclaimed historically since 1810. So now, I have collected the several evidences from the coastal environments of India. Number one, that is increased sea surface temperatures, increased frequency of high magnitude cyclones in the Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, increased concentration of short-term rainfall, ocean acidification, sea level rising processes, impacts over the boundary conditions of the regional coastal systems, that is very critical situations that has arisen at present along the coastal fringes of India. Then increased rate of coastal erosion, drowning of the coastal wetland habitats, and indirect effects on the coastal soil quality, agricultural productivity, coastal aquifers, and livelihood security of the coastal people. So first point I am discussing on the increased sea surface temperatures. The sea surface temperature is rising at the rate of 0.6 degrees centigrade per decade since 1950. Effects include circulation changes, sea ice reduction, coral bleaching and mortality, species migration, and algal blooms. From this diagram, you can see that since 2002 to 2020, particularly in the month of March and April, the sea surface temperature is very, very high, and it is recorded from the northern part of the Bay of Bengal. Here, I can say you that the average sea surface temperature is 25 degrees centigrade. So if it becomes 26.5 degrees centigrade, there will be the occurrences of the low pressure cells over the sea surface areas. So now the sea surface temperature has risen up to 30 degrees centigrade, or in few years, it has actually risen up to 31 degrees centigrade. And in the next slide, I am showing you that since 1946 to 2001, there is a tendency of the sea surface temperature rises. And this is from the Andaman Sea area. And from some area, you can see that 1991, 95, 98, and 97, the sea surface temperature was recorded as 30.1 degrees centigrade. So ultimately, this tremendous increased temperature of the seawater will actually causes the acidifications and the coral bleaching. And here, from this particular table, you can see that in the year 2016 in Andaman coast, in our Andaman islands, South Andaman area, we have recorded 32.1 degree centigrade, 31.7 degree, 32 degree centigrade, 32.3 degree centigrade temperatures. So such tremendous temperatures of the seawater are actually responsible for the occurrences of the low pressure cells and the activities of the low pressures and intensifications of the low pressure into the storms and further intensifications into severe storms. So in the next point, I am coming to discuss about the increased frequency of high magnitude cyclones in the Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea. So here you can see that a large number of high magnitude tropical cyclones hit the coastal fringes of Bangladesh, Myanmar, West Bengal, and Odisha since 1970 along the Bay of Bengal shoreline. Effects include altered storm surges and storm waves and sediment transport. Here I have documented the few high magnitude cyclones since 1970 to 2020. That is the Bula cyclone in 1970 in Bangladesh, 1989 Sundarban cyclone in West Bengal, 1991 Sundarban cyclone in Bangladesh, 1992 Bhitarkonika cyclone in Odisha, 1999 Paradip cyclone in Odisha, in 2007 the cyclone Sidar in Bangladesh, 2008 Nargis cyclone in Myanmar, 2009 Ayla cyclone in West Bengal, 2013 Phailin cyclone in Odisha, 2014 cyclone Hudhudhu, Odisha, 2019 cyclone Phoni in Odisha, 2019 cyclone Bulbul in West Bengal, and 2020 the Umphun cyclone or Amphan cyclone in West Bengal. And from this frequency of high magnitude cyclones in the northern Bay of Bengal, here you can see that since 1880 to 1980, the high magnitude cyclones I have considered, I have picked up the data from the IMD sources, that 240 kilometer per hour wind speed plus. So 240 to 260 kilometer per hour wind speed cyclones I have considered. So ultimately the six cyclones of super cyclones actually took place in 100 years period. But since 1989, we are actually getting more than 12 high magnitude cyclones till Amphan cyclone in 2020. That indicates the magnitude and the intensities and the frequencies of the cyclones are actually recorded, particularly in the northern part of the Bay of Bengal. So this is the top 9 intense and the strongest cyclones in India, other than northern Bay of Bengal. That is the cyclone Okhi 2017, cyclone Bharda 2016, cyclone Hudhud 2014, cyclone Phailin, cyclone Helene 2013, cyclone Nilam 2012, cyclone Fayan 2009. Next. So this is the impacts of the Umpun cyclone in our West Bengal and Odisha parts very recently in 20th May 2020. And INCOAS actually has recorded the impacts of the cyclones over the coastal Bengal and coastal Odisha. Here from this diagram, you can see that what happened on that day, the cyclone of 200 kilometers per hour actually crosses the border of West Bengal coast near Sagar Island and across Mohishadol, Noyachor, Tomluk area, and from Tomluk area to Kolkata. And it was stranded for 2.5 hours period over Kolkata. And torrential rains actually took place during the stranded cyclone in that part. And from that part, again, the cyclone has moved towards north-northeast in one branch, and in another branch, it moved towards east, towards Bangladesh. So when it moved towards east, towards Bangladesh, at that time, the high tide was active in our West Bengal portions of the Sundarban and Bangladesh portions of the Sundarban. So the entire areas of the inner parts of the Sundarbans are actually were affected by tidal waves and tidal surges, both in western part of Sundarban, that means our West Bengal, the Harwa, Minakha, Boshirhat, Hasnabad, these are the Sandeshkhali, Hingalgon, these are the areas mostly affected by the tidal surges in our West Bengal portions. But when it hit Sagar Island, at that time, the 2 meters storm surges actually took place. So in the afternoon period, when it hits the coast, at that time, the 2 meters surges, the storm surges actually took place along the border areas of the Sundarban. And then in the afternoon period, the tidal surges actually took place. So that's why the entire Sundarban area was devastated by the occurrences of the Umpun cyclone. Then the storm surges actually why occurs in the Subarnarekha deltaic area, in the Mahanadi deltaic area, and also Brahmoni, Boitarani delta, and in our Sundarban. Sundarban is famous for the occurrences of the storm surges. Considering the favorable conditions of the Bay of Bengal and the bathymetry of the Bay of Bengal, another important observations is actually schematically represented by me on the basis of the increased level of the seawater for which the actually storm surges and its impact take place over the coastal area. Here, just to follow the diagram, the normal low tide water in the region is minus 0.30 meter. Mean sea level is 0 meter. So normal high tide is 3.5 meter to 4.5 meter up to Sundarban, from Subarnarekha Delta to Sundarban Delta. And when storm surge occurs because of the concentration of the low pressure, due to the low pressure, the storm tide occurs and the storm surge occurs up to 4.5 meter rise of the water level actually, usually took place during Ayla cyclone and during the previous cyclones in the area, and over which the wave set up, so which is almost 2 meter, that is six, so up, ultimately 6.5 meter increase of the water level, and then the extreme winds so piled up the 6.5 meter raised water surface in the form of the storm surges up to 8.0 meter wave run up over the land surface. But the relative level of the land surface at the seafront of the Sundarban areas or in the Subarnarekha areas around the dunal parts, that is 5.5 meter. So ultimately, the inundations will be 2.5 meters. In this way, we can predict that. So 2.5 to 3 meter surging waves may inundate the entire southern parts of the Sundarban, the low-lying areas of Sundarban, the low-lying areas of the Subarnarekha Delta, and the low-lying areas of Mahanadi Delta and Boitarandi Delta. So this is the favorable conditions for the surging waves in this area. Then I am coming to the increased concentration of the short-term rainfall. So short-term rainfall on 26th to 27th July 2005, when Mumbai flood actually took place, rainfall occurred in 24 hours period, recorded as 576 millimeters. In July 2020, Mumbai recorded 1475 millimeter rainfall, and the city has surpassed the earlier highest rainfall record of July in 1951. Rainfall recorded in South Goa, 150 millimeter, and in Karwar in northern Kannada district, actually 300 millimeter during Nisarga cyclone, June 3 to 4, 2020. Kerala witnessed 951.4 millimeter rainfall for the month of August 2020 and recorded 821.9 millimeter in August 2018 during the devastating floods. Tamil Nadu floods in 2015, 9 to 16 November, witnessed 570 millimeter rainfall. Torrential rain causes deadly flooding in Tamil Nadu on 30th and 31st November in 2017. Particularly Chennai recorded 169 millimeter in 24 hours durations. And Kolkata witnessed 244 millimeter in 24 hours period during the Umpun cyclone on 20/05/2020. And Sundarban received 166 millimeter in 24 hours period. So this is the short-term concentrations of the rainfall events, which actually took place in the few decades, both on the western coast and the eastern coast. Here from the slide, you can see that the consequences of Chennai flood in 2015. And it took place in 14 December, and property damages estimated $199 billion US dollar. And human deaths actually over 500 persons. You just look the situation of the airport, the marina sea beach, the seaside marina sea beach, you look that it is over, it is flooded. And then the cars are drowned. And here you can see that how the situations of the residential complex of the Chennai city, and then the railway stations, you look. Next. This is the Kerala floods. Duration, July 2018, August. Human deaths, actually over 483 people died and 140 are missing. Property damages estimated as 400 billion US dollar. Here you can see that Kerala also getting the huge amount of the short-term concentration of the rainfall. And that's why 2018 actually witnessed the tremendous devastating floods. And in the same way, Mumbai is mostly affected. In 2005, just property damages estimated 5.50 billion US dollar. And how the Mumbai city is actually getting affected regularly by the concentrations of the rainfall. Even in this 2020, also the huge rainfall actually taking place in the month of July and August. So short-term intensities of rainfall events, a few cases already I have mentioned. And lastly, I am just going to mention that the Kontai cyclone in 1997 in our Midnapur coastal belt received 494 millimeter rainfall in 48 hours duration. So these are the records collected from different sources, particularly during the occurrences of the cyclones and the concentrated rainfall in few cases from the coastal belts of India. Next, I am coming to the point on ocean acidification. Ocean acidification is the ongoing process in the ongoing decrease in the pH of the Earth's ocean caused by the uptake of the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. So seawater is slightly basic, and ocean acidification involves a shift towards pH neutral conditions rather than a transition to acidic conditions. May 2000 witnessed the pH values of seawater in Andaman Sea ranging from 7.50 to 8.80, minimum to maximum. So 7.50, it is rarely actually take place in Andaman Sea. It is almost 8.50 or above 8.50 is the value. So 7.50 is the value which is representing the towards acidifications of the seawater in Andaman. And what are the effects? You can see that from this diagram, the coral bleaching in Andaman Islands. Underwater photographs captured at North Bay coral environments in Port Blair, just nearby the Port Blair, on 26th April 2016, showing primary signs of the coral bleaching. You just look at how the green pigments of the coral have been affected, the Acropora group of the corals particularly affected severely over the shallow surface of the one coral area or warm water coral area in the Andaman. Next, the time series composites also of biweekly hotspot for the Andaman Islands. Here you can see that just on the right hand side, you can see that how the acidifications and the warming are actually gradually increasing just at the adjacent parts of the Andaman Islands. The red color tone indicates the highly vulnerable areas of the Andaman seawater for the acidifications and for the high SST concentrations in this area. And here you can see that from other parts of India, that is Rameshwaram Island, we visited several times for our research work. And there we have seen that how the coral has been bleached in the near shore area of the Rameshwaram Island. And the bleached coral debris are actually distributed along the shore fringe areas of northern part of the Rameshwaram Island. Next, the sea level rising processes. Now, thermal expansion of seawater by absorbing the heat energy from the atmosphere and by accumulating the volume of glacial meltwaters will produce the global rise of sea level. IPCC predicted a long-term rate of sea level rise for 100 years, 1990 to 2090 span. There will be 40 to 50 centimeter rise of sea level during this period. The IPCC now estimates seas will rise between 26 and 82 centimeters. Between 1901 and 2010, global sea levels rose by 19 centimeters, an average of about 1.7 millimeter per year, in October 3, 2013 IPCC report. Between 1993 and 2010, sea levels rose by 3.2 millimeter per year. So short-term increase of the sea level is very significant, almost twice the long-term average. So global mean sea level rise in between 2081 and 2100, relative to 1986 to 2005, is very dangerous. The new scenarios of the future climate change called the representative concentration pathways, RCP. So all assume some carbon cuts take place with the exception of the highest emission scenario, RCP 8.5. The report suggests a global mean sea level rise of 0.98 meter by 2100 under the highest emission scenarios relative to 1986-2005. Even higher projections of up to 2.4 meters have been suggested. So in the previous slide, I have shown you that your city may go underwater by 2050, and this city is the Mumbai city. Mumbai city is always getting affected by the seawater, particularly during the monsoon periods. But in the near future, the city of Mumbai, Chennai, Cochin and our on the eastern coast, the Kakinada and Puri and Digha and Haldia. So all the cities located along the Indian shorelands are very, very vulnerable to the sea level rise impacts. So IPCC's RCP 8.5, the curve shows that maximum rise will be 2.4 meter. So if 2.4 meter sea level rise takes place, then what will happen? Just to follow the diagram, that from the UNEP, it is estimated that if there is 50 centimeter rise of the sea level takes place by 2050, then how much area, the green dots of the Sundarban portions of Bangladesh, showing that how much area will be affected by the sea level rise impacts. And I have estimated personally after 2002 that 12% areas of the agricultural land of South West Bengal will be affected because of the 50 centimeter rise of the sea level and the inundations, the seawater concentrations and the saltwater encroachments and the inundations by the seawater. So ultimately, the rice productions will be affected severely in the near future in the Sundarban tracts in our West Bengal portions and in Bangladesh portions. And then if it is 2.0 to 2.5 meter rise, sea level takes place, then 35% areas of Bangladesh up to Dhaka, Mymansingh area, and our Kolkata will be affected severely by 2050 or by 2100. So naturally, here is the high curve, best curve, and the low curve actually given by IPCC up to 2100. Next. And some sea level anomalies are also recorded from the Andaman Sea, from the Thailand area, Phuket area. And here you can see that since 1993 to 1999, the anomalies though are recorded, but during 96 and 97, the sea level is showing the significant rise. So, and the fluctuations are there, the anomalies are there, no doubt. But particularly during the period of the ENSO and the El Nino times, and also particularly during the IOD events, Indian Ocean Dipole process, the sea level becomes affected severely. Next part, I'll discuss about the impacts over the boundary conditions of the regional coastal system. That is very critical conditions. The environmental conditions of the coastal morphodynamics. Here, this is the diagram of the coastal morphodynamics. Actually, coastal morphodynamics is that along the coastal fringes of Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea, there are the regional coastal systems having their boundary, the local boundary, that in which the local systems actually with the help of the sediment grains and losses and energy losses. So energy and sediment, and then their processing. So ultimately sediment transport and processes actually make the system, and ultimately the morphology is developed in the form of the diverse characters along the shorelines of the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea in different regional areas, regional pockets. And ultimately, the stratigraphy has been developed. So this is the local systems. Within the local systems, there are some static and dynamic factors which control the boundary conditions, and they can influence the local coastal systems boundary. And among them, the environmental conditions, which are the static and the dynamic factors, they can be divided into two categories. One is the in situ, that is the geology and human activity, and second is the ex situ, that is the sediments and the external forcing factors. So I am worried about the external forcing factor, that is the climate change, the sea level variation, and cyclone landfalls. So these are the actually the external forcing factors which are actually disturbing the local regional coastal systems in the coastal areas of India, both on the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea. The boundary conditions of the regional coastal system of Indian subcontinent are increasingly affected due to the frequent landfalls of the high magnitude tropical cyclones, with geographically diversified areas of estimated cyclone vulnerabilities. So under such conditions, the geomorphology will be changed along the shoreline. And that's why the shoreline erosion activities are actually gradually increasing along the Bay of Bengal and also along the shoreline of the Arabian Sea. And some impacts of the cyclones, you can see that how the coastal fringe forests, which includes the mangroves and non-mangroves, are affected severely during 1989, during 2007, during 1999. So ultimately, the habitats will be affected severely. Already we have the record from the different cyclone impacts and the huge sediment displacements, the sediment transports from the top surface of the habitat areas. That actually has exposed the underlying clay bases along the shoreline, which are actually getting affected by the wave scouring at present, which is actually disturbing the adjustment possibilities of the shoreline against the energy and the sediments. And here you can see that the partial destruction of mangroves along the shore fringes. If you visit the shore fringes of the remote islands of the mangrove dominated Sundarban, there you can see that how the relict patches of the dead mangroves and the partial destruction of the mangroves you can see along the shoreline, which indicates that over the decades, the storm impacts and the impacts of the sea level rise are actually drowning the mangrove wetlands at the southern part of the Sundarban at a regular basis. And from the remote sensing images, we can measure it. Okay, next. So increased rate of coastal erosion, I am showing you in the next part. These are the, under climate change, sea level rise is expected to bring about large changes in the world's coastlines. Now, research predicting future shoreline change from satellite data indicates loss of nearly 50% of sandy beaches by the end of the century. So this is the latest paper written by Shu Brooks from the Nature. I have collected, and combinations of storms and sea level rise will affect future shoreline change to varying extents around the world. Writing in Nature Climate Change, Vosdeskas et al. Show the potential for erosion of large areas of sandy beaches by 2100 using a recent satellite derived global surface water database. And the person and his group actually selected 2.5 million actually coastal transects over the globe around the coastal areas. And ultimately he has generated a graph from which we can identify that the concentrations of the coastal erosions are actually maximum in the tropical coasts. And if you just match the longitudinal value that India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, so the South Asian coasts and also Southeastern coasts will be affected severely because of the vulnerable conditions of the coastal hazards. And these are the photography of 1980s from Sagar Island, Fraser Gorge and Bokkhali. Perhaps you are regularly visiting the coastal areas of Sundarban. So when we started our research work in 1980s, the beginning part of 1980s, at that time over Sagar Island, the height of the sand dunes was recorded by me in several places as 14 meter to 7. You imagine it. Then there is no trace of dune along the shoreline of Sagar Island. And at Bokkhali, up to 10 meters to 12 meter sand dunes also, I have recorded from the photographic documents during my research time. And at present, there is no trace of the coastal sand dunes, only having some foredune morphology, which are very, very dynamic and getting affected by the erosions and the tidal surges. And in Fraserganj, you look, the such a high dune was located along the Fraserganj coast just in the beginning of the 1980s. So all these dunes are actually removed. So they have been diminished actually along the shore line, but they acted as the physical buffer and a physical barrier against the tidal surges, sea level rise effects, and other wave effects. But at present, what we have seen that there is no trace of the sand dunes, which acted as the physical barrier against the settlements, which are located just behind the sand dunes. So now they are exposed to the seaward sites. So they are getting affected severely in case of Mausuni Island, in case of Fraserganj, in case of Sagar Island. We have seen how they are getting affected, how the villages of the reclaimed Sundarban are getting affected due to the immediate effects of the cyclones in the area. And that's why the displacements of the settlements that I have recorded from the different islands. Next. And here, from another photograph, you can see that northwestern part of Noyachor Island, 6 meter exposure of the mud banks. So I have identified their stratigraphic positions of the different mud banks and their characters on the basis of the sedimentological studies and also the bioturbation activities and their stickiness characters, the color of the muds. So these are the phenomenon that we have considered during measurement of 6 meter sections of the Noyachor Island. This represents the origin and the formation of the Noyachor Island in this part of the Hooghly estuary. Next. And then NCSCM, another organization from Chennai, which are actually producing the erosion status of the coastal states of India regularly. And here from Odisha coast, here you can see that they are actually, they have 7 coastal districts, and among them, 2 coastal districts are getting affected severely by the erosion. That is 40.5% and erosion of 52.5%, actually taking place just in the Mahanadi Deltaic area and in the Puri district area and Ganjam district area. But towards north, you can see towards Bhadrak, Balasore, and also Bhitarkonika area, here you can see that there is the map showing the accretion of 73%, 57%, 51%. But recently, I have visited many times in the years 2015 to 2018, I have seen that the tremendous rate of erosion is taking place in these areas. So continuously, the erosion processes are actually disturbing the shoreline positions. And that's why the rate of shoreline recession is very high in the alluvium coasts of Odisha and West Bengal, so far as it is recorded. Next. And these are the products of the erosion atlas of the shoreline erosion atlas prepared by the NCSCM from the different sections of the coast of India, starting from Gujarat to West Bengal, that you can get. So here, this is the one example of the shoreline erosion atlas, and they have categorized that more erosion, medium erosion, less erosion, then stable. And then again, the more accretion, medium accretion, and the low accretion. So 7 scales measurements they have considered. And particularly, they have identified the areas of erosion affected conditions and situations of the shoreline, because each and every sections of the shoreline are actually related to the livelihood conditions of the people and their activities. Because our ports, our fishing docks, and our fishing activities are based on the characters, shoreline characters, and the shoreline geomorphology in the eastern parts of India. Next. Here you can see in the Subarna Rekha how this part is affected by the erosions. And Subarna Rekha mangroves are now exposed to the shoreline. And that's why every year, the wetlands of the Subarna Rekha Delta are getting drowned by the advancing sea and the impacts of the sea level rise in the area. Next. Then the drowning of the coastal wetland habitats. Next. Here you can see that the global warming-induced sea level rise will inundate the mangrove wetlands of the Sundarban in the near future. The Royal Bengal tiger, the last refuge of the Sundarban, will be vanished if the wetlands are drowned by the sea level rise. Only 50 centimeter rise of the sea level can inundate 12% areas of West Bengal, including the Sundarban by 2050. This is my work. And here you can see that, the photograph, you can see that. This is the typical effects of the swell waves across the shore fringe settlements. The clear sunny day, but eastern wind started. And the occurrence of the low pressure sail in Andaman area, and from which the winds started. And after one day, the velocity peak of the wind reaches in the Sundarban fringes. So that's why from the eastern winds, and also the longest phase, that is about more than 1,000 kilometer phase line distance. So high waves are actually breaking along the shore fringes. So these are known as the swell waves. So we have actually throughout the world, the two different types of the swell waves. One is the east coast swell wave, and second is the west coast swell wave. So west coast swell wave is the very dangerous, because their effects over the amplitude of the wave, the significant characters will be very, very dynamic than the eastern swell waves. But this is Sundarban area, it is affected by mostly by the east coast swell waves. So if it is affected by the west coast swell waves, so naturally all the alluviums of the coastal belt actually will be engulfed very recently by the level rise. So but on the Arabian Sea, the west coast swell waves actually regularly taking place, because that is the rocky coast. So still the recession and the rate of the recession of the shoreline is minimized. So this is the character of our environmental conditions, which are actually getting more and more dynamic and engulfing the areas after areas of the settlements in the Sundarban. That's why the displacement of the settlements are actually taking place at a regular way in different islands of the Sundarban. Here you can see that how a large tract of the mangrove forest in Bhitarkanika and Subarna Rekha Delta, how they are drowned, they have been affected by the advancing sea. So mangrove wetlands in future also may be vanished if such rate of the sea level rise takes place in the coastal areas. Next. And here from this diagram, you can see that the changing mud banks of the delta will influence on the morphodynamic characters of the ever-changing depositional surface, and also will be in complex adjustment with modern sea level rise. Here, over a island of the Bhitarkanika, the entire mangrove tract and the salt marsh tract of muddy or clayey compositions. So now it is affected by the movement of the sediments during the cyclones, which actually advanced towards the inner part of the island. And the salt marshes and mangroves have been trapped by the advancing sand seeds. And here you can see one boat is also sunk, also have been affected by the depositions of the advancing sand seeds over the islands. So in this way, the phenomenon of the sea level rise impacts will take place in the shoreline areas of the eastern coast in India. Next. And here you can see that inland village of the Sundarban area with the temple site under saltwater inundation during 2010 to 2018. Within this period, regularly, it's a regular phenomenon, but it is located about 3 kilometers away from the shoreline, but still the inner areas are getting affected where the settlement, the permanent settlements are located. Next. So lastly, I am coming to the indirect effects on the coastal soil quality, agricultural productivity, coastal aquifers, and livelihood security of the coastal people. Next. Here you can see that how the salt encrustations takes place after the occurrences of the tropical cyclones in the deltaic area. Here I have measured that 14 millimeter thickness of the salt particles have been actually deposited, and it is encrusted over the soil in the deltaic areas after Ayla cyclone from Gosaba area and from Basanti area. Next. The tidal, the inland movement of the high tide through the estuaries, that has been also advanced towards the inner parts of the West Bengal and Bangladesh. That means with the gradual rising of the sea level process and by the impacts of the cyclones, so because of the sediment movement into the estuaries and the tide waters also will be advanced towards the inner part of the estuaries and the tidal rivers in the Sundarban. Here from this diagram you can see that how the boundary of the soil salinity and the boundary of the inland advancement of the tide water actually has been shown in this diagram. Next. And then the aquifers, the coastal aquifers. Here from the Central Groundwater Board, I have collected this diagram. Here you can see that the coastal aquifers in the Sundarban, in the deltaic area, they have the alternate, the fresh groundwater and the saline groundwater pockets in between the confined and the unconfined layers. Here you can see that the red color layers are the saline groundwater, which are very close to the surface. So in the near future, our soil quality will be affected, our freshwater quality will be affected, and also the agricultural characteristics also will be changed in the Sundarban in the coming decades. Then how the coastal aquifers are actually getting affected? There are several causes: the relative sea level rise, changes in hydrological regime, and then rivers and estuary, the conditions of the rivers and estuary, the annual floods are not taking place. Some catastrophic floods are only occurring in the deltaic areas all over the India. And then the coastal zone, the erosions and shoreline retreat also responsible for the contaminations of the coastal aquifers. Then human activities are also responsible because of the over extractions of the water from the areas. So automatically the cone of depressions will be developed. Ultimately, the encroachment of the salt water into the coastal aquifers will take place. Then countermeasures. Here you can see from the diagram that how the saltwater, freshwater interface actually getting exchanged by the tidal pumping and dispersive circulations, that runoff and the waves. And particularly if in the settlement area over the inner part of the island, if the over extraction of the groundwater takes place in the sensitive interface area, that is occurring in our Sundarban area, so automatically the saline groundwater will push into the inner parts of the coastal belts. So from the recent report of the CGWB, I have seen that from Tamil Nadu to West Bengal, up to 4 kilometers to 5 kilometers track, coastal tracks are getting affected by the encroachment of the salt water into the coastal aquifers. And here you can see that how the groundwater contaminations actually takes place in the coastal area. So confining layer, alternate confining layer, and the superficial aquifer, confined aquifer, confined aquifer. So the seafront positions of the aquifers are actually open to the sea in the continental shelf and the continental slope. So they are exposed to the sea. So automatically salt water and fresh water mixing is taking place. And then if sea level rise takes place, so vertical mixing from confining to the confined layer, that may take place. So this type of the exchange of the fresh water and saline water will create the contaminations of the groundwater in the near future, and already have taken place all along the coastal areas of the subcontinent, what is recorded by the CGWB. Then the effects of sea level rise on the reclaimed Sundarban, because our certain portions of the Sundarban are actually protected by the dikes or embankments. So automatically, along the tidal rivers, if there is the significant tide level increases, because LTL, HTL, and STL, so these three phases are actually recorded from the estuaries, the tidal rivers and estuaries, the low tide level, high tide level, and significant tide level or the storm tide level. So storm tide level or the significant tide level only take place during the cyclone breaks and also particularly during the sea level rise. And also because of the huge siltations in the river beds. So automatically the tide level will be increased even in the normal conditions. Here, the photographs are showing that in the month of December, how the at the time of the high tides, the saltwater encroaching takes place or taking place just across the embankments where the agricultural lands are located. So the soil salinity is the tremendous problem in the Sundarban at present. If the occurrences of cyclone takes place at regularly, so automatically the entire Sundarban agricultural lands will be affected by the salt encroachment. And then the flooding, the erosion, then mangrove wetlands, these are the phenomenon which already affected, which already I have shown several times that how the Sundarban area, the people of the Sundarban area, their settlement area, their livelihood, their areas of the livelihood affected, and then the habitat dynamisms. So that is actually taking place in the Sundarban area because of the sea level rise and also by the global warming effects. Next. So finally, I can say that the indirect effects of the storm surges and sea level rises include the salinizations of the coastal soils in the low-lying delta platforms, reduction in agricultural productivity, saltwater encroachment into the coastal aquifers, impacts on the livelihood security of the coastal poors along the shore fringes. And I have already documented the livelihood security of the coastal people along the coasts of Odisha and West Bengal by my PhD research scholars over the decades. And there I have seen that how the coastal poors are getting more and more affected because of the shortages, because of the reductions of the natural coastal resources, which actually were available in the near past when the concentrations of the populations in the coastal area also was very limited. So now our tourism process clearly dependent, the coastal tourism clearly dependent on the characteristics of the beach character, beach processes and the beach materials. Because if it is sandy beach, so it is favorable for the beach tourism activities. So now if the beaches of West Bengal and Odisha get affected seriously by the occurrences of the sea level rise and the global warming induced processes, so automatically our economic activities also will be affected, not only for the tourism activities. Today is the tourism day, so International Tourism Day. So on that eve of the day, I am to say that the future of the coastal tourism is very bleak, particularly for the cases of the beach tourism activities in Odisha and West Bengal. And you can see that our crabs, the red crabs, they are now endangered and their habitats are actually getting affected because of the removal of the sand size materials from the beaches at a regular way because of the landfall of the cyclones, by the hammering process of the cyclones on the coastal areas and gradual increase of the sea level in the Sundarban. So presently, we know that because of the thermal expansion of the seawater, the sea level, the rate of the sea level rise in the Sundarban is varying from 3.4 millimeter to 5 millimeter per year. This is the highest if you just compare with the other areas of India. In Gujarat also, It is almost 3 millimeter per year, three to 3.5 millimeter per year. But in Sundarban, it is highest because of the thermal expansions and because of the subsidence of the deltaic platform in the area. So in future, people have to think about the sustainable use of the resources to reduce carbon, to reduce warming, and to reduce the hazards in the coastal area. So thank you, everybody. I finished my lecture. Hello. 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 Question will be told.
How to stop and decrease global warming?
Kothay question ta? Question. By P.K. Roy, sir, how to stop or decrease global warming without stopping development in recent time? Yes, this is the major problem.
Thank you so much, sir, for your informative and excellent lecture. I'm sure that all of us present here has been very much informed by your enriched lecture. Now we will have our interactive session, which will be hosted by my colleague, Srimati Debarpita Banerjee. Over to you, Debarpita Di. Thank you once again, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. We are very much enriched by your lecture. So now we are going to conduct the interactive session. We have received a series of questions from our participants, which are very much relevant to the topic. However, due to the paucity of time, we may not be able to answer all the questions, but we will definitely try to reach to all. So, yes, sir, so the first question to Professor Paul, that is, sir, is there any chance for cooling phase instead of the sequential warming? This question is by Mihir Kumar Pradhan to Professor Paul.
Yes. Cooling process, actually, we are advancing towards the cooling process after completion of the warming phase of the Holocene period. So we will, at least we will reach again in the cooling process, but when our Holocene systems and Anthropocene systems will be finished, when our developments, the global warming and the emissions of the carbon dioxide and other gases will be reduced. Then again, by the cyclic way, we will advance towards the cooling process again.
Thank you, sir. The next question is to Professor P.K. Roy by Shourodeep Odhikari. What are the effects of global warming in animals as well as in human beings? And what are the suggested remedies?
Well, that is a very good question. Let me tell you one thing. I would like to focus on the remedies first. In that context, I can tell you one thing that you have seen perhaps the cinema Ice Age. This film has depicted that during glaciation, except African continent, no other, and Tibetan plateau, all other lands were. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, 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 sir.
Except African continent and Tibetan plateau, all the areas were submerged by sea water, but finally we emerged as victorious. So I would refer to another point in this regard that this thing, any crisis can be considered as opportunity. During all mass extinction period, all the students of geography, they are quite aware that in the definite interval, there were some period of alternate cooling and warming of Earth. And during warming and cooling period, many of the species disappeared. This disappearance of species has finally given rise to a new species, which are always better than the previous one. For example, dinosaurs. Dinosaurs or Tyrannosaurus, they are now no more in this world. But new species emerge. Other than few fossil animals like crocodiles and few other animals, those who have survived all along. But other than that, the new species has emerged. So new species will emerge with the process of time, with the process of climatic change. There is nothing to worry about. And finally, for human being is always, can survive in the extreme conditions with the help of their technology. So a human being on one hand is destroyer, and on the other hand, they will be the innovator and they will emerge victorious from this deadly menace of global warming. And finally, I would like to refer comment by legendary scientist Stephen Hawking in his book, A Brief History of Time. Here he said that this tiny globe is not enough for our human being. Let us search another space for the future generation of human being. Let us go for the exploration in the space. So this is a much ambitious word, but this is the final destiny of human being.
Thank you, sir. The next question is to Professor Pal. Sir, how will the coastal people of Bengal adapt with the sea level rise in the recent context of socio-economic development? It is by Shubroto Jana.
Yes. Socio-economic development, it will continue. You cannot control the socio-economic development, because in the Sundarban area, we know that about 76 lakhs people are at present living in the, particularly in the reclaimed Sundarban tract. So their socio-economic development, it is also dependent on the protective structures like embankments and others. But gradually, they will develop in their own way. But nature will actually create the impacts over their developmental activities. So this is a typical co-adjustment between the adjustment power of the people and the natural phenomena. So if people can adapt, so they can continue their development, but their development should be sustainable. And their development, suppose the people who are cultivating agriculture, the agriculture, the rice, the crop, rice crops or the paddy crops in the alluvium, coastal alluviums. So if the soil becomes saline in this area, so salt tolerant rice plants should be planted. That is another way. And some wetland areas which are already drowned by the advancing sea level. So naturally in those areas, the fishery activities may be introduced in that area. So in this way, in every sector, people have to adjust with the natural phenomenon. So in this way, who can adjust? Only they can survive in this area. Otherwise, many, many people will migrate from this global warming induced pressures over the local environment.
Exactly. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Next question is again for you, sir. It is by Shribas Kanji. How will the hydromorphodynamic activities change with sea level fluctuation?
Yeah, that is a very interesting question. It's a theoretical question. But if the sea level rise takes place, that means the elevation of the water. The elevation of the water will be increased. And that is taking place in the Sundarban area and in the deltaic areas, particularly of the on the eastern coast of India. So if level of the seawater increases, so horizontal advancement of the seawater or the encroachment of the seawater into the low-lying area will be increased. So the impacts of the waves, impacts of the tides, and impacts of the coastal currents will be encroached into the inner part of the coastal area, across the embankments, across the protected structures. So this is the typical hydrodynamic activity that will take place in the Sundarban area. And that's why recently we have actually observed that the mud banks are exposed, the relict mangroves are exposed, and the submerged forests are also lying in the shore fringe areas. That means the Sundarban mangroves were actually in the recent past towards the sea, but the shore fringes are actually getting affected because of the rising sea level. So under the stress of the hydrodynamic activities, the wetlands are not adjusted. There is a threshold limit of the mangroves to accumulate sediments under the rising sea level. That is the 6 millimeter, at the rate of 6 millimeter per year. So up to 6 millimeter per year, if accumulation rates made by the one species of the mangrove, if takes place, then that mangrove species can survive under the hydrodynamic pressures, hydrodynamic regimes. And morphology, that means particularly the sediment movement and the erosion, that actually will take place. And the sediment transport also will be very important characters under these hydrodynamic regimes, increased hydrodynamic regimes. That is the inland movement of the sediments. So that's why all the estuaries, all the inlets, all the river mouths will be affected by the reduced depth of the water because of the depositions. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Next question is for Professor P.K. Roy, sir. Sir, how to stop or decrease global warming without stopping development in recent time? It is by Ranjit Bishash.
Well, development will continue, no doubt of that. We cannot stop development for the survival of human being. But already Dr. Paul has already indicated what are the measures to be taken. Already in Sundarban area, you know, in the last year or two, mangrove afforestation is being taken. A massive project has been undertaken by West Bengal government. And, you know, this high tide areas, some of the dikes, which were ardent dikes, which were devastated. And instead of that, they are suggesting concrete dikes should be placed, even particularly after Ayla, the mud dikes were all, some of areas, they were breached and they were, in fact, destroyed. instead of that, this concretization may take place. But not only mere plantation of mangroves and the concretization of the dike is enough, but other than that, they are to undertake this Jal Bharo project. That is, they should keep all these all their efforts to store the rainwater or sweet water in order to combat this saline water. There are some other measures. I'm not going to the detail because we don't have this much of time.
Thank you, sir. The last question by Monikuntala Kanrar. Sir, it is for you, Professor Pal. What will be the actual fate of Sundarban in relation to climate change and rise of sea level?
So, this is the ultimatum of the Sundarban. That's fate of the Sundarban and the survival of the people in the Sundarban actually dependent just on the activities of the global warming induced sea level rise and the frequency and magnitude of the cyclone landfalls and the cyclone related processes. So I think, to my opinion, at least a few areas of the coastal fringes should be removed. That means settlements should not be there. So settlement relocation process should be introduced immediately. Otherwise, if you just relocate the settlements from those areas, and those areas are actually covered by the mangrove plantations initiated by the local organizations and the government, so automatically that will be better for the fate of the people of the Sundarban. Otherwise, people have to migrate from that area. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. It was very informative. Now I would like to request Dr. Moushumi Basu to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Devapita. Good evening, everyone. It's my privilege to deliver the vote of thanks on this occasion. I, Dr. Moushumi Basu, Faculty of Geography Department, Prafulla Chandra College, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the principal, Dr. Ratnakar Pani of Prafulla Chandra College, for his continuous support regarding the conduction of this webinar. Further, I would like to express my sincere thanks to the speaker, Professor Ashish Kumar Paul, for gracing your work and sharing with us
Go ahead, Moushumi. Moushumi, go ahead.
I would like to acknowledge Dr. Mona Basu, a faculty member of the college, conducting the webinar.
I think Mohana, you continue. Mohana, can you hear me?
Participants for being with us. Thank you all.
Yeah, sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
I'm also having some network issues, so yeah, she's back.
Hello.
Go ahead, Moushumi.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes. You are very much audible. Go ahead.
Yes. Finally, my gratitude to the Dr. Sheikh Abul Salem, librarian, Shippur Dinobondhu Institution, for providing us immense technical support.
You're audible.
Otherwise, this event like this could not have been possible. I also thank all the participants for being with us. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay, here ends our webinar. Finally, I again express my gratitude to Dr. Ashish Pal. Okay, here ends our webinar. We can leave now.